Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your brother from another mother, coming to you on the video on demand via YouTube and other sources, who knows, with the internet from the awesomely fabulous state of North Carolina. Hope you guys are all doing all right tonight or today, whenever you may see this. Pray that you are walking in the will of the Most High God in your life. And I pray that you're walking by the Spirit of God. For the Bible says those who are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. So anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord just dropped some awesome things on me this afternoon. And yeah, I'm wearing a... Actually, you know, I do have a couple of suits. And I had them mothballed out there in storage since I've been in the Philippines. And so I thought I would, you know, start dragging them out here and wearing my sports jackets here, the jackets. So praise God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, today the Lord gave me some awesome messages. And the Lord gives me great wisdom. And sometimes, you know, I don't have time to share it. But by the grace of God, you know, I want to share all the things the Lord showed me. So those of you who know, been watching my videos in the last few days, I've been talking about this 4 and 4, 4 and 4, 4, 4 and all that. Today, I had an open vision of 4, 4, 4, brothers and sisters. And the Lord still has not fully explained or released me to talk about these things that are coming in the dreams and visions that I've had. But I just want to say this. People want the 30-second soundbite, brothers and sisters. But the way God speaks is in parables and metaphors and examples and types and shadows and all those things. For he who has an ear to hear what the Spirit of the Lord would say to his church. You know, so most of the time, you know, that's the way God operates. When I've dealt with pastors sometimes, you know, the Lord would give me a situation to rebuke them. I mean, that's what you do in the prophetic ministry, you know, and I'm a pastor, but yet a prophetic ministry of a pastor. And so the Lord would put me in with these difficult cases sometimes. And as a matter of fact, let me just make a video about that. Is because the Lord is leading me to talk about it. And all these things are pointing to, are for a reason, to teach us things. And they point to the end times. But this particular story that's coming to my mind from the Lord. I had, in 2003, I helped plant one Filipino church, and then with a church from the Philippines in the northern part of the Philippines where the former Clark Air Base used to be. But the other two Filipino churches, you know, I was the only pastor. But this other church, they had a small group of about 6 or 8 people in another city in North Carolina. It's about an hour from here. And I would go there and help them, you know, get started. I was their pastor when they didn't have a Filipino pastor. So every other 6 months they had this was on Sundays. You know, by the grace of God, just FYI, I started, the Lord gave me the leading, and I started a home church on Friday night that became a church with a group of nurses, Filipinos, nurses mainly from Manila. Saturday night I had a group of mainly school teachers who were from the other parts of the Philippines. And then Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, we met in a community church. They allowed the Filipino group in Greensboro, North Carolina, to use their sanctuary. So 3 days a week, those 3 days, I was pastoring for 3 days every weekend. So praise God for the grace to do that while I was going to Bible school. But anyway, the Lord is leading me to talk about this situation that happened with a church that I helped start, with a mother church who was sending a pastor to plant this church, but he had problems with his visa. He had to come every other 6 months. When he was not there, I pastored. But anyway, I worked with them. You know, if those of you who are my regular viewers, you know this story. I've talked about how that I had a long-lost great-great-aunt who I hadn't seen since I was a kid, who never had children. And then when her husband died in the time that she turned 90 years old, and she invited my grandfather to help her. And my grandfather was having heart trouble and all of this. And my grandfather ended up dying within about a year of this, her contacting him. So during that process, back in 2000, 2001, I began to help her. And so I ended up inheriting her land, and then the Lord made a way. At the day she died, they came to me and said, hey, we want to build a shopping center on this land, and we want to buy it from you. So the Lord brought it all together, and during that process, I was processing and going to school and working with Filipinos and preparing to go to the Philippines, which I did in 2007. So during this time period, that church knew about my situation, that I was helping my elderly great-great-aunt, and she had a piece of land that I knew was, after I started helping her, she told me, hey, this land is going to be valuable one day, and I want you to have it. She was telling me that all the time. And for the 6 years that I helped her. And during that time, I'd shared with that church, the pastor, the head pastor in the Philippines, it's about a 3,000-member church, I shared with him the fact about this, that one day, praise God, then I could go into full-time ministry. That was my prayer and my plan, to go to the Philippines and be a missionary and be a full-time minister. And I already had started to see, hey, this is the vehicle of how God will do it, And so that church turned to find out that when I went to visit the Philippines, this pastor was actually homosexual, and I actually walked in on him. And I didn't suspect that he was. I didn't think so, but I knew he wasn't married and all these. I kind of had fleeting thoughts of why he's not married in his 40s, but kind of find out that's the situation. So after that, when I saw it with my own eyes, and then I also didn't have a translator when they were preaching, and then I found out later from some Filipino pastors who could speak English who talked to me that what they were saying is that the senior pastor there, when in Malachi, when it says, I will send the fourth Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers, he was saying it's talking about him. People turning their hearts to him, pastors turning their hearts to him, and he's like the father of all pastors, and which is also cultic stuff. Besides his secret sexual activities, homosexual activities, he's also preaching a false gospel. I didn't know any of that because I didn't have a translator, and I went around with them doing crusades and all this kind of stuff, and I preached with a translator for me, and I preached the gospel and all that, and and also revival to pastors. We had pastors' conference with 1,000 pastors. The problem in the Philippines, there's lots of poor people, lots of poor pastors. And if you're going to give them a free meal, transport them there, give them a free place to stay, hey, they'll come listen to anybody say anything. And they won't say nothing to your face because, hey, it's a free trip, So, and that's the sad part. And that's why it's very, in my mind, when the tribulation happens, hey, they can buy these people for a sack of rice. Hey, you take the mark, we'll give you a sack of rice. Okay, hey, people are so easy to sell out. Especially in a poor country like the Philippines. Anyway, so that was the head pastor, but there was another pastor that was coming back and forth who I talked to. And now he was actually effeminate, but I didn't know, didn't ever caught him or knew of him being gay. But a very effeminate guy too, or very, more effeminate than the head pastor. But I don't know for a fact. I never saw him do anything or heard that he was doing anything, but it's probably so. But anyway, the Lord had spoke to me a question to ask them, because after all this went down, it all went, God's timing is perfect. This all went down right when I was selling the land after my aunt had died, my great-great-aunt had passed away. It all came together, and then that was the time for me to sell the land, get ready to go to the Philippines. And so they contacted me and was pressuring me, you should give a tithe to us, to all this, There's like they worship the pastor. His nickname was the Pope. They called him the Pope or Papa in the church. And he wanted to be treated as, I'm not going to get into all the details, but the guy was, he had 12 assistant pastors, and so it's like he was Jesus, they were the apostles. And no, if anybody wanted to give them something, nobody in the church could give any of the pastors anything, they had to give it to him. And then he would dole out to his 12 assistant pastors, anything that he might want to share something with them. total dictatorship and all kinds of other, besides all the other things. Anyhow, you know, the Lord, since my ministry is prophetic, that's the type of people that the Lord sticks me with, because he wants me to bring that word, you know, and it's a tough assignment. A lot of you guys and these people on YouTube and all that talking about, they're prophets. And they're on there, you know, willy-nilly calling people names and all that. They don't know what it's, you know, that when you really are in the prophetic, it is really tough. And it's the people that you least suspect. You know, like the Antichrist is going to be loved by everybody. But people who have an ear to hear and eyes to see, it's going to be lovable. So when people come out and say, hey, this guy's the Antichrist, blah, 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 it's not going to be a popular thing. You know, it's not like someone that's evil. Oh, Hitler's evil, Hitler's evil. Well, yeah, get on the bandwagon, you know, stand in line, you know, to cast stones at Hitler. We all know that. The Antichrist is not going to be like that. So anyway, the Lord gave me this word. I'm trying to remember exactly what it was, but it's something like this. I told them, if you had a son, this is the word that the Lord gave me for them. If you had a son, and he was going to marry this woman, you know, and this is the parable the Lord gave me for that pastor, for those pastors of that church, 12 pastors and then their pope. If you had a son, and he was about to get married, and he loved the woman, and he wanted to marry the woman for love, but the woman wanted to marry your son for money, because your son had money, and they wanted, and the bride wanted to marry your son, and you found out in advance that this woman was deceiving your son and wanted to marry him for money, and then your son was in love, wanted to marry her for love, what would you do? You know, and they said, well, we don't know what this parable means, but they were kind of like the Pharisees. They're like, well, we don't know what the parable means, but of course, you wouldn't want your son to marry somebody that wants to marry for money. I said, that's right. And what would the father do to that woman? What, you know, knowing that she's trying to deceive his son and get his son to marry for money, when, you know, and deceive and hurt and destroy his son. And so that was the parable that the Lord gave me, basically. And of course, it was them, you know. I was, you know, trying to, you know, connect. They were inviting me to connect with their ministry, and I wanted to, you know, and I knew the Lord was calling me to do mission work in the Philippines. I was like, I'll just connect through this church. You know, and I didn't know about their false doctrines, and I didn't know about their homosexuality, and I didn't know that they were also just using me for money. The Lord revealed it to me, or I would have never known it. I was like, hey, these people love me. They love me so much. This is awesome. This is from the Lord. You know, and then, but the Lord sovereignly revealed to me. As a matter of fact, if you guys who follow me regularly, you know, there's a black group, a church, a black pastor who started a, you know, an all-black church, but me. I was, you know, it was another preparation of me to go into working cross-cultural, you know, the Philippines, part of that process. I was assistant pastor in a church, too. They met on Sunday morning. I did all those. I didn't mention. Yeah, I did a Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday morning with the all-black church, but me. And then Sunday afternoon, of course, it was all Filipino, but me. All the other groups are Filipinos, but me. So, anyhow, the pastor of the black, you know, the historic black church, you know, the black pastor, I just use that as descriptive because it was because of the cross-cultural part of it and cross, you know, different traditions and stuff, preparing me for what I do now. We prayed, he and I were prayer partners for about 4 or 5 years. We prayed almost every day for at least 2 or 3 times a week for 2 or 3 hours. And, so I totally trusted him, and he told me, you know, there's something wrong with this man. He never met any of them people. He never went to the Philippines, never met them, never talked to them. He told me, he said, there's something wrong here. You know, there's some deception going on, and the Lord wants you to, you know, the Lord wants to talk to you about this, and I don't know what it is, but. So that brother of mine, a true brother of mine, you know, warned me. You know, and I was like, well, you know, I trust him, but what is he talking about? Maybe he's wrong. And I thought maybe he was wrong, but I kept it in the back of my mind. Turned out to be that's what it was, brothers and sisters. They wanted to try to get the tithe of my money, steal that tithe for their own ill-gotten gains. As a matter of fact, they got sponsorship from lots of big American churches across the U.S. And as a matter of fact, those American churches, let me tell you something else, just to give you a lesson. I hate to, you know, be the bearer of bad news, but there's a great big church in Memphis, one of the largest churches in Memphis, a predominantly white church. I'll say that, I guess. The pastor is. I met him. I didn't go to their church, but he came here and met with the Filipino pastors. And what he did, he went to his church, about 3,000 people in Memphis. He raised money, thousands of dollars, to send to the Philippines. And I was the one who carried the money. And he actually gave, like, it was either $800 or $200. I can't remember. It was a small amount compared to what he raised. Because I heard him saying, you know, to some of his people came with him, some elders or whatever. And he was saying that he raised thousands of dollars to send to the Philippines. He was advertising that. But the amount he gave, I had a list of all the people that donated, including myself, that I hand carried this money to the Philippines. You know, at that time, this is 2005 maybe. Early, this was in April 2005. And you can carry $10,000 cash in and out of the United States. I had under that, but I can't remember the amount. But anyway, I had a list of all the donors, some Filipinos who are doctors and nurses and all this, and myself. And that church, like I said, it seems like they gave $200, but it may have been up to $800, whatever it was. It wasn't, you know, so I assumed that they raised thousands of dollars and they just gave a tithe of it or whatever. You know, they didn't say that to anybody. But I was the one that saw it myself because I had the itemized list. So this is the kind of things that you deal with, brothers and sisters. It's sad and true. So the corruption. Of course, the Lord knows all these things, and all these people have to answer to the Lord. And anyhow, I wanted to make this video and just discuss that. And I guess the theme that I'm trying to get to here, the theme that the Lord has given me for this video, that I'm saying, you know, recognizing the enemy is very deceptive, brothers and sisters. He's very deceptive. And in all these different ways, brothers and sisters. I mean, and before I made this video, I was thinking about this afternoon. You know, I don't want people, because I know there are people who are paranoid, okay? Don't be paranoid about it. But Jesus said you have to be as wise as a serpent, but harmless as a dove. You know, so we need to understand and be wise to the ways of the enemy. As Paul said, we're not ignorant of Satan's devices. So we need to be wise. We need to be prudent. Not like President Bush Sr. Yet. Wouldn't be prudent. But no, we need to be prudent, and we need to be wise, and we need to be cautious. You know, because for me, believe it or not, I'm so quick to trust people. Even today, I'm slow to judge people. But in my touring around the states, in some of the situations I've been in, as you guys who watch my videos, you know I've talked about it. I've learned to be more, I take that back. You can never judge a book by its cover. Let me say that. You can never judge a book by its cover. As a matter of fact, as you know, Jesus was born in a manger. The opposite of what the world would say, you know. But that doesn't mean that everybody born in a manger is Jesus. That's a good one right there. Just because Jesus was born in a manger doesn't mean everybody born in a manger is Jesus. Not all poor people are great. Not all people that look dirty are great. But there are people who look dirty and, you know, dirty clothes and all this kind of stuff who are actually Christians. And they're not drug addicts. But there are people that look like $1 million. And they're drug addicts, you know, you can't really tell. That's what I'm trying to get at. The enemy is very deceptive. But we don't want to be overly paranoid about it. That's why I wanted to say that was my caution when I was going to make a video and get into this. Always pray for discernment when you're dealing with people, especially in the church, not only in the world. You already know about the world. You can't ever really trust anybody in the world. But in the church, you have to be very cautious, brothers and sisters. I have tons of experiences like that in my ministry and call, you know, as a really in the prophetic to deal with those pastors who are doing wrong. And it's tough. It's tough. And I thank the Lord, though, that the Lord has, you know, given me these opportunities to mature and grow in that. So thank the Lord. That's what I pray, that I have a phase of doing that again at a higher level. Even though it's very difficult, I believe, you know, by the grace of God, I'm more mature and experienced now to do better than I did when I was first starting out and doing it. Anyway, God bless you guys. I have more videos to make. I'll be back.